Our traveling group, along with our guide Josue, had been touring several Central American countries. We went to Guatemala and its capital and the largest city in Central America, Guatemala City. We were taken on a tour, passing many of the statues that line the avenues there. Church is a private chapel that combines Baroque, Byzantine, and Moorish elements favored by its owner. It's certainly unique. We stopped briefly at Plaza Berlin. Three sections of the Berlin Wall were moved here in 2014. As a reminder of the fall of the wall, one piece is turned on its side. In the 1800s, many Germans immigrated to Guatemala when free land was offered to them. Many more came during the two world wars.
The old version of downtown, that is where we're going to get out of the bus and walk for about 30 minutes. And when we get over there, and I will remind you of this, I will recommend that you remove your earrings, okay? So, and then stay together. And so this is the U.S. Embassy. Over here to the right, you can see the people who are applying for a visa. It's $200 a fee. And they raised the fee like 40%, I know, because I have applied four times.
Oh, wow.
The Central Plaza is the hub of the oldest part of the city. We were dropped off at the plaza. We walked to a portico and then into an arcade.
Just come all inside because I need you all within my sight.
We had several reasons for this stop. First, for a baño break. Then, to sample the cervezas mixtas, tap beers that are mixed in large pitchers. The long wooden bar and the bullhead on the wall made it feel like something out of a Hemingway novel. This is a storied place. Our main reason to be here was to have a drink at the same bar where a regular customer was Che Guevara. The Argentine hero lived here during the 1950s. As a young medical student, Che traveled throughout South America, and while here was radicalized by the poverty, hunger, and disease he witnessed. Che Guevara's book, The Motorcycle Diaries, chronicle his life-changing trip.
Right, those seven of you who raise your hand.
We also raised our drinks of cervezas mixtas in memory of Che Guevara and his fight for the rights of the people of Central America. Guatemala was a banana republic because it, and most of Central America, was once controlled by the banana-growing United Fruit Company. United Fruit, with the help of the U.S. government and local wealthy families, had an enormous impact on the economic and political development of Latin America. United Fruit exploited the workers and decimated the land by destroying the rainforest and creating gigantic banana plantations. CIA Director John Foster Dulles, who instigated the overthrow of the Guatemalan government, and his brother, who sat on the board of directors of United Fruit, branded the workers communists. Workers were brutally murdered, and the land severely degraded. United Fruit created terrible long-term environmental and economic consequences. The subsequent numerous civil wars resulted in terrible massacres and torture. The names of some of the victims are memorialized on pillars in front of the Metropolitan Cathedral.
We drove out of the city to learn about the Guatemalan chicken bus. As many Guatemalans are illiterate, they use the colors of the chicken bus to determine its route. By U.S. law, a school bus must leave service after 150,000 miles or 10 years of service. Buses are then sold and driven down south, where they are usually remodeled as chicken buses. If you miss the bus that carried you and your first sweetheart to grade school, you may find your bus again, remodeled and painted in bright colors.
This bus had 13 seats each side. Yorita was it?
Yes.
And now it's 10. ¿Y cuánto le cortó desde donde? They cut from somewhere he has his hand, that's as long as it was, so they removed 85 inches. So they moved the rear axle. And here he says that this bus was flat. And they just moved the part of it. ¿Qué es lo que movieron, el chasis o la...? So the owner didn't want it flat anymore, so he wanted to have this section put in right there. ¿Y alguno de estos que usted le haya cambiado el motor?
Solo este.
They changed the engine right here, Ketani. So the owner, entonces el dueño, oh, that, the engine on that bus was put right here. ¿Cuántos caballos tiene? Okay, I'm asking him how much money he will charge the person who is paying for this work. And he's going to charge $4,266. And you don't have, you know, aquí esto todavía lo van a pintar, ¿verdad?
Sí,
pintar. Yeah, but this is going to be a beautiful hood because everything will be chrome, he says. Mm-hmm. So.
Solo lo adaptamos.
Yeah, they only adapt.
Parte es el taller en Chapar.
Yeah. Pero ustedes no reconstruyen motores.
No, solo adaptamos.
Yeah, they do not reconstruct. They simply...
That's what the specialist.
Somebody else does that.
Yeah, that's somebody else, yes.
So this was a flat.
Okay, run for that orange bus. Josue will buy the tickets. Just try to get a seat up front if you can. Wow, we did have some chickens on our bus. Maybe they were just babies, but chickens nonetheless. With no speedometer, we didn't know how fast we raced along, now on the great Pan-American Highway. Bus drivers are very proud of their vehicles and invest in keeping their buses safe. Even though we had stopped at the bus chop shop, we passed our own tourist bus while we were speeding down the road.
Gracias.
one which produces the best coffee in the world. And Guatemala is one of the top five as far as quality. We're going to see the farmers here. So, and this is your only opportunity to get to see, you know, some coffee before it's roasted. Guatemala does not roast coffee. Guatemala does and is consumed right here, but most of the coffee which is grown in this country is sent outside. And there are eight regions which grow coffee in the country, and this is the one where the coffee trees are known as Robusta. This is the beginning of the season. Okay, so if one of these days you drink Guatemalan coffee, chances are it's from this part of the country. Okay, so this is a work that is mainly done by the adult males. Children are hand-picking the coffee. Okay.
Many coffee farmers receive prices for their harvest that can be less than the cost of production, forcing them into a cycle of poverty and debt. They're often required to sell to middlemen who pay them half the market prices, generally between 30 and 50 cents a pound. Family farmers usually bring in a cash income of $500 to $1,000 a year for their very hard working efforts.
We drove into the magnificent central highland city of Antigua and checked into our luxurious Hotel Camino Real. We wandered through the lush courtyard to find our sumptuously furnished room. After unpacking, we had dinner on a terrace under twinkling lights. Then, in the morning, we went in for our breakfast in the dining room, decorated with beautiful antiques and Spanish colonial style fittings. Josue explained that our first stop was to see the view of Antigua from above the city at the Hill of the Cross. The entire city is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. The first capital of Spanish colonial Central America, Antigua was founded in 1543. It was partially destroyed by its looming volcano in 1776, and this old city was then ordered abandoned. Not everyone left, and it became a provincial town filled with the ruins of former glory and ultimately became known as Antigua Guatemala, or Old Guatemala.
All our birds
have the name of the identified bird, with their name right there and also his name. Sometimes we want to mount it.
Que sea similar a su hábitat.
In a place that is similar to the to its habitat.
Y entonces el alambre a nosotros nos da ese margen
para poder it makes it much easier
entorchar y colocar en una rama de árbol.
And place it on a tree.
Espero que esta demostración les haya gustado,
entretenido, and that this has been a little entertaining.
Y sea un bonito recuerdo la visita de esta.
After watching the beautiful ceramic birds being made, we went into the showroom. One thing we wanted to see on this trip was the quetzal bird. Señor España showed us his version, maybe the only quetzal we would see, as they're very elusive. Several ceramic birds came back with us for gifts. Walk through Antigua, down lanes, and through courtyards to arrive at a sawdust artist workshop. There, we met Señor Chacon, who practices the tradition of decorating the streets with fabulous carpets made from sawdust with various colored dyes added. A sifter is used to sprinkle the sawdust over various templates to produce a wonderful variety of designs.
Y en Antigua es igual.
En Antigua es más grueso porque las piedras están disparejas. Well,
in Antigua, because the surface is uneven, we have to make them a lot thicker. ¿Cuánto tiempo se ha tomado Don Carlos para hacer una de sus alfombras más grandes que se ha creado?
Aquí en Jocotenango, el tercer domingo.
The third Sunday.
A las 3 de la mañana.
Of Lent. I'm asking him, what's the time that he is right. Taking to make the biggest one? He says,
De la
mañana o la noche?
De la mañana.
Okay, they start at 3 a.m. and they finish at 11 a.m. So it's an 8-hour photo stopping.
Oh. Wow.
During Holy Week, the colorful sawdust art appears on the roads and inside churches. Thank you.
right, let me introduce you to national pride to us in Guatemala. His name is Tomás Cárdenas. Tomasito, how old is he?
73.
He's 73 years old. I used to be a farmer.
Sí, después gracias a él ya vine a ver qué hacía porque no tenía trabajo.
And then you know when I came to this place and I had to find something to do.
Empecé haciendo estos bananos.
And then I started making bananas. I'm only going to use protection for my eyes when I am sharpening my tools.
So his son.
Yes.
Señor Cárdenas moved to Antigua and became a woodcarver, making wonderful lifelike creations, which he ships all over the world. Maybe you've seen his work in Pier 1 or Cost Plus.
We had seen La Merced Church from the hill overlooking Antigua and driven by it in our bus. Finally, we were able to see La Merced up close, with all its fancy plasterwork. It didn't suffer damage in the 1776 earthquake and has always remained open. Alas, its original sculptures and altars were removed to the new city, Guatemala City. The huge volcano dominates the skyline, especially in the beautiful central area of town. Before heading back to our hotel, Josue took us to an ancient mansion converted to a posada to see and hear a wonderful Guatemalan invention. The first historical mention of the marimba shows it was initially played in the main square in Antigua in 1680.
Okay, so we're now driving to Santo Domingo. We want you to see something different that a lot of the people don't get to see when they visit these premises.
This is one of the most beautiful museums we have in Guatemala. They are very small, by the way. The whole complex is a museum itself, but there are full areas which have been open for creating this museum and displaying the wealth that this family has. So this. It's a very famous convent, or it was one of the most important ones in colonial times. And today it's been remodeled and turned into a hotel and a restaurant.
Judith Bautista was our very knowledgeable local guide, beginning at the converted convent of Santo Domingo. We began our tour by going down into the Silver Museum. There you find a collection of items obtained from various churches. The light made them look golden. Many pieces were attached to statues as a radiance or halo. There were censers and a wonderful monstrance, which I was particularly interested in as I wanted to buy one on this trip.
Thank you.
came up into a courtyard of the partially earthquake-destroyed convent and its lovely old garden. Santo Domingo was once one of the grandest convents in the Americas. The hotel is notable in that it preserves many of the architectural ruins from the Baroque period of colonial Central America. The Colonial Museum holds mostly wooden statues that were owned by the countless religious organizations in Guatemala. We visit a part of the crypt with the remains of former nuns. Then we climbed a spiral staircase back to the ground level. The Museum of Pre-Columbian Art and Modern Glass holds stunningly beautiful displays. Venetian glass urns are shown beside ancient Mayan temple urns. A French dome owl is displayed next to a terracotta Mayan owl. Two Mayan jade crocodiles are shown with a Czech crystal piece.
We took our bus back to the center of Antigua. It was time for lunch, which we ate in the garden of Les Tres Tiempos. Next to the restaurant is the iconic symbol of Antigua, the Santa Catalina Arch, which connects a convent to a school, allowing the cloistered nuns to pass from one building to the other. We wondered what opinion the nuns would have of the VW under their arch to advertise a nightclub. We had a bit of free time and thought this is a splendid place for a souvenir photo of our trip to Guatemala.
Next to the arch is a jade store. Harry took particular care in selecting a jade necklace as a special gift. I showed my photo of a monstrance to help in finding what I was looking for. The clerk recommended a shop down the street. Off we went. Luck there either. Time to rejoin Judith and the group.
addressing the problems we have. We used to have more than 300, but now things have changed, you know? And not too many people were wearing the main dress.
Ah, sí.
But you can still see some of them, even you can see the kites.
Left the Marvelous Collective and headed out down the cobblestone street for the main square. We noticed a man on the corner with what looked like a monstrance. Alas, it just wasn't right. We passed a bakery with just the thing. They said go further down the street to a shop called Quetzale. We went inside and looked around at all the beautiful objects. And then there it was, up on a shelf. Hooray!
We caught up with Judith and the group in the main square. As the one-time capital of Spanish colonial Central America, this square is filled with wonderful architecture of the period, including its old cathedral. This is the square where the marimba was first recorded having been played. It's most famous now for its unique mermaid fountain. After enjoying the band in the main square, we walked on, passing a number of magnificent old buildings, many in an exquisite state of dilapidation. We headed back to our hotel as the two of us were joining our five friends from San Francisco and returning to the gorgeous Casa Santa Domingo Hotel, this time for dinner, in their restaurant.
Versos del alma, Guantánamo.
It was Sunday morning on our final day in Antigua. We went out into the quiet and astonishingly beautiful streets. We wandered under the Santa Catalina Arch, aiming toward the Sunday market that's held in front of a partially ruined church with a breathtaking view of the volcano rising in the distance. This trip will always mean color to me. We were constantly surrounded by the bright, bold colors of magnificent Guatemala. Our group was waiting for us at our Camino Real Hotel. We were off this day for a late afternoon flight to a beautiful lake in the Petén jungle near the city of Flores.
Our room overlooked Lake Petenitza. It lies about 16 degrees north of the equator. There are at least 27 Mayan sites nearby. One near Flores was the last Mayan city to be conquered by the Spanish in 1697. We left our hotel on the lake and drove a bit to get to the incredible Guatemalan National Park, which includes the ancient Mayan city of Tikal. You first encounter the visitor center with this Mayan glyph showing the symbol of Tikal. Inside is a giant model which gives the layout of the pre-Hispanic city and its numerous giant temples and causeways. The name Tikal means the place of spirit voices. Our first stop was a ceremonial platform fronted with a series of stelae and altars. Josue said this was a great place to get a view of our first destination for the day.
At the top, we could see across the rainforest to the Great Jaguar Temple. The first destination on our tour of Tikal. Then we began to hear howler monkeys in the trees above us.
You see the branch coming out like this?
Yeah. Oh, I see him. Hey, you.
Hey.
Oh yeah. Is he a little one or is he?
He's a fully grown one.
He's cute. He's sweet.
How wonderful to hear the howlers, even though we only saw one of them. Beyond, we walked behind our first huge temple rising up in the rainforest. There are temple complexes all over Tikal. In the early 1850s, a report of the ruins of an ancient city in the rainforest of Guatemala were published in newspapers. It was revealed that the monumental architecture was from as far back as 300 BCE, although the main buildings here are from the classical Mayan period, circa 200 to 900 CE. Josue wanted us to see the ruins of one of the apartments of the royal family.
26 successor behind, the father. So the father, the son, but this man is the father of the one we saw the first complex already. So, but he built his palace much larger, 5 levels instead of 1 like the father, blocking the best view the father may have had during his lifetime. And you're going to see the best view he had. Really, really beautiful. Okay, let's come down here. We'll go get...
The royal palace rooms were beautifully constructed with an ancient wooden lintel over this doorway. The room contained a window and various ledges, one for a bed. Rod demonstrated the size of the Mayan king-size bed. The stone construction in Tikal is fascinating. Finally, we made it to the Great Plaza. We entered down some steps to find the many Mayan buildings, stelae, and altars, some protected by small individual huts. There was a shaman leading a service of some kind. Josue didn't know who or what it was.
Turkeys appeared as we left the temple complex. Native of this area, turkeys were brought from the New World to the Old World, and then, after some hybridization, they were brought back again. These are your Thanksgiving turkeys' ancestors. A sudden tropical rainstorm began as we continued toward our final destination in Tikal. went up some wooden stairs. On our way, we met a man with quetzal feathers in his hat. This is as close as we would get on the trip to a real quetzal. We'd finally arrived. We walked on to the front of Temple 4. It's a stunning view of endless rainforest. We could see the rainstorms in the distance. The sounds of the jungle surrounded us. Out in the forest were the temples we'd visited. We felt such happiness to be in this magnificent place in this very remote part of the world.
We had arrived at the city of Panajikal. We were dropped off in the center of town so we could shop our way to our hotel on Lake Atitlan.
So these are all the towns around the lake. And tomorrow in our program it says that we depart from here and we go to Santiago to visit a 16th century church. Very interesting, by the way. One of the first churches in Highlands. So there's more Mayan motifs here. And also, we see a very controversial deity known as Ma Shimon, the great grandfather.
The last hotel on the trip had a stunningly beautiful view of a volcano. We had left one hotel with an amazing lake view for another even more spectacular view. We began our festivities for Rod's 73rd birthday the following day when Katie gifted Rod with a glowing fluorescent lasso.
After breakfast, the next morning, we set off on a tour of the area. First, we stop by Lake Atitlan, the deepest in Central America, at about 1,120 feet deep. The lake is an enormous caldera formed from a volcanic eruption 84,000 years ago. Josue gave details about the terrain while we looked over a manicured farm plot filled with the most superb, perfect-looking onions.
So we're going to drive about 30 minutes.
Maybe you've downloaded
to get to San Antonio.
Yeah.
Once we get to San Antonio, we'll visit one of the several co-ops that are in town. And this co-op has about 40 ladies working together. So there's a lady who represents all of them. So we'll see some of them weaving. And I will take you to see a family, a traditional family. And so you can see the original dress for the woman and the man, because it's changed a lot.
Paulina is the lady in charge, or the leader of this group of ladies who weave to make a living. Paulina, puedes dar unas cuantas palabras?
Sí, en inglés.
Hola.
Hola.
Buenos días.
Buenos días.
I'm asking her how many ladies are involved in this project, and she says there are 40. Sí, es que más, contanos.
Nosotros trabajamos sobre la cooperativa, tenemos diferentes mujeres.
So in the co-op we have a lot of women.
Mm-hmm. Mujeres, viudas.
We have widows.
Problemas del Agatha.
So we have some of the ladies who were affected by Agatha. ¿En qué año fue ese?
En el 2006.
In 2006 we had a Hurricane Agatha. And she, ¿cuántas casas estuvo aquí?
Aquí como hay unos
30. There's a little waterfall coming from out of the mountain, and during that time, more than 30 homes were all washed down to the lake. I meet the parents, Juan y Juana, John and Joan, and see what they eat.
The women's co-op was on the first floor of a three-generation home with a family of 14. We went upstairs to the living quarters to meet the grandmother.
Of course. And I brought you here because they will be some of the very few locals who still wear their traditional dress. And you can see the girl, ¿cómo te llamas, nena? You can see Lilian. She's wearing a new color. Okay, so this is a traditional skirt. This is made of wool. This is something from the 16th century. Men still wear, and sometimes they weave their traditional garments. So weaving is something which is mainly the responsibility of the lady while the man goes to the field. In the traditional way, that's still happening. I'm asking Juana, because these are for your wrist, how long she takes for making one, half an hour. No, the whole 12. Packet, the 12, are $1.
There are 12 bracelets in there.
Right here, yes.
12, one American dollar?
One US dollar, that's, uh-huh. I brought it here because, you know, when you come back here and if you want to buy something, be aware that you are very directly helping.
The hillside kitchen contained a 3 lava stone hearth. It was exactly like the one we had seen in an ancient Mayan village from around the year 600. The sauna was also like the ancient sauna we had seen from the same period. Thank you.
We boarded a speedboat for a trip across Lake Atitlan. We passed fishermen out probably for largemouth bass, which are abundant in this lake. There aren't many roads around the lake. Most towns are accessible only by boat. We crossed to the opposite side to go to the town of Santiago Atitlan.
Well, he welcomes you to Santiago. Santiago, ¿cómo se llama Santiago en Chutuhil?
Skin High.
Skin High is the native name for Santiago. Okay, so Roberto will accompany us while we are here, and he will also get us the trucks.
Santiago Atitlan is a tourist town, so is filled with vendors. They're very polite while hoping to sell us their colorful souvenirs. We walked on through the town to find a Maya chapel where a shaman was scheduled to meet us. The deity Maximan is a folk saint venerated in various ways by the Maya people of Guatemala. The veneration of Maximan is not approved by the Catholic Church. However, he's venerated by many indigenous people. It's thought that Maximan is a form of the pre-Hispanic Maya god Mam, blended with influences from Spanish Catholicism. It's been suggested that the name Maximan is a combination of Simon and Mam, the Mayan god and word for tobacco. He's frequently given offerings of cigars. Linda and Katie had arranged for a special consultation with Nicholas, the shaman. The rest of us waited outside to give them some privacy.
Next, we walk to the large church dedicated to Santiago, St. James the Apostle. It dominates the far side of a large square. Franciscan friars arrived here in 1538 and founded a congregation. The church was built beginning in 1572. Up the 450-year-old stone stairway, we entered the church. This church has been restored and reconstructed several times after significant earthquake damage. It's lined with wooden carvings of saints, each dressed in a fabric tunic. They're made by the local women and are changed each year. Its marvelous carved wooden altar is partly hidden. It was created in colonial times, but restored after an earthquake by two Maya brothers. This is when it's believed to have acquired its mixture of Maya and Catholic symbols. Saints climb to the summit of the altar, which represents the three volcanoes that tower over the village. The church also has a distinctive statue of Santiago riding a mule and wearing boots. Mm-hmm. Harriet remained outside sketching while we toured the church. He was our expedition artist. He had attracted an audience because he makes really excellent drawings. Then we had a demonstration of the women's distinctive red turban worn in this area. This demonstration has been speeded up.
She does it every day, and you know, the meaning of the turban is not a protection against the sun, because this is called the top of your head. The meaning of it is the turban is a representation of the umbilical cord. It's also the snake which means fertility, and the snake is also what arches over our heads. The name lives away. Okay? And so this is what connects us with our
The red turban appears on the 25 centavos coin. The banknotes, called quetzales, include that elusive quetzal bird.
Some of the men in the area wear distinctive clothing too. As today was Rod's 73rd birthday, he was chosen to demonstrate.
Happy birthday to you.
All right, who's got the camera? We need this one.
Oh, that's you. That's you, Rod.
No.
I'll also the chronicle for I just returned from Guatemala.
Oh, wait a minute. Not done yet. Oh.
Oh, wait, we're not done yet. Got to have a serape.
But wait, for 29.99.
Hey, extra. All right. All set.
No one bought one of the men's outfits, but we carried on with our sightseeing. We came upon a wonderful gallery filled with oil paintings of people and scenes of Guatemala. Now you got our attention. We succumb to the bright colors of Guatemala and the excellent brushstrokes of Nicholas Rionda. The oil painting was removed from its stretcher. Then, a young man cut a piece of plastic conduit and the painting was rolled to go inside for safe transportation. Afterwards, we boarded the back end of a pickup truck for the wild ride through town and the countryside.
Adios, amigo!
What fun is that?
too.
We made it back safely. It was evening, and we went to celebrate the birthday of Rod, or Don Rodrigo, as he was now known.
He'll be a challenge to the tuk-tuks.
Well, you all look like you're in section.
Celia, the last lady who still makes pottery, or she will give us a demonstration just for us. And then we'll drive on the Pan American Highway again to see the...
We had driven out of town to a small village where we walked to the home of a venerated woman, the last known artist who makes pottery in the way of the ancient Maya.
All right, friends, let me introduce you to... charming lady. Her name is Basilia.
Sí.
Doña Basilia, ¿cuántos años tiene usted?
Tres.
Oh, she's only 73. So, what Basilia does is that she goes up the mountain across the Pan American Highway to collect a special kind of clay.
Yes.
The clay, she brings it down in sacks, and the second step is to grind the material. The third one is to mix it in water and leave it for several days. The fourth one is to grind more because she is going to start working with the whatever piece, either a griddle, a pot, or a water collector.
So where does she collect the clay from?
She goes across, she up this part of the mountain, across the highway, and keeps on going. Yeah, she says, I bring it to a little pool.
That's how she carries it?
Like that.
Oh, wow.
Okay, Lila, let's see you.
Ay, me van a mandar mi foto. Yo.
Señora Vasilia prepared the earth in the ancient way that has been practiced here for thousands of years, kneading the clay to create the proper consistency for a pot. The potting wheel was unknown to the Maya, so the potter, literally, was the wheel.
Once it's dry, sun dry, she comes to put, well, she says the ear. She collects another kind of clay, okay? Because she doesn't want the piece to be burnt, to be black. So this is a coating.
Espera unos 20 minutos, luego a poner a pisar.
Once she applies that, she waits 20 minutes. And then she starts using that stone to polish it. But he didn't know until recently.
Luego hace, prepara el fuego, lo quema así al aire libre.
Now what she is telling me is that once the piece is finished like this, she has to bring twigs. And this is what she calls shikai. The shikai is twigs. She puts it in the floor. She sets it on fire. And she puts the piece. And once it's getting burned, she's going to bring this. Once it's ready, once the fire is on, and she puts the pieces, she adds one last thing. And everybody knows this. And pine needles. For quanto tiempo?
Horas.
And she keeps on feeding the fire for 2 hours. Okay, this is what she used to make in large scale. Like, now she's reduced the size. Now she's making this. So these are candle holders. Okay, when you see them, they are only to be used for candle holders.
We were driven out to the city of Sololá to visit a local market there. Had walked from the retail to the wholesale part of the market in Sololá. Each distinctive outfit with its unique colors disclosed which village the person came from. It was lovely to see something besides the ubiquitous jeans and t-shirts on the men. Sway bought a few items in the market, and then we followed a woman balancing her purchases on her head, going down the ramp and back to our bus. Gary and Lele had decided not to go with us on our next escapade. There were 8 different zip lines where we would fly over the rainforest in this 247-acre nature reserve. Several men helped us to put on our harnesses. They also then helped us at the various trolley stations. We were really excited to be in the rainforest to do a zip line. We all donned our hard hats in preparation for the adventure. Then we had a small test to help everyone understand how the equipment worked. There was a small line to test our ability. If you chicken out with the small line, you're not meant for the 8 wild rides high above the trees in the jungle.
Now? Yep.
Wow. Good.
It's amazing.
Finally, off we went through the rainforest. You have to climb in order to get enough elevation to have an exciting zip line experience.
Thank you.
Don't let go.
Okay.
Okay.
Time to get
bye. Okay?
It's short.
That was good. Well,
Johnny Wise knew.
Oh, he looks like a man.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, here we go. Woo-hoo!